A quick announcement before we dive into this episode of Swift News. I just launched my brand new iOS dev course where we build a portfolio piece using SwiftUI, HealthKit, interactive Swift charts, and throughout the course we use basic source control with Git and GitHub. We also cover error handling, basic unit tests, basic accessibility, empty states, and we'll even build a nice GitHub README to showcase our project. So if you want to check that out, go to seanallen.teachable.com. Link will be in the description. All right, our top story, of course, is WWDC 2024 was announced. And rumors are that iOS 18 is going to be one of the biggest iOS updates yet. Seems pretty clear that Apple's going to announce their plans for AI and showcase all that stuff. There's even some rumors of a visual redesign to look a little bit more like the glassy feel of Vision OS. Now, all that stuff, as a consumer, I get so pumped. As a developer slash content creator, I'm like, oh boy, could be a lot of work coming my way. But either way, it's the best time of year. So exciting. June 10th to the 14th is the date. I can't wait. And in preparation for that, Apple has created their own Apple developer YouTube channel. Step your game up, Apple. Only 60K subs? Come on. I'm sure that'll change real quick after WWDC. But yeah, Apple's going to post all the WWDC videos to their YouTube channel, which I think is great. It just makes it more accessible to more people. You get into people's recommended feeds in the YouTube algorithm. I believe all the 2023 videos are up there if you want to get caught up. But during the month of June, I imagine all the 2024 videos are going to be uploaded here as well. And speaking of YouTube channels, if you're interested in growing your app's downloads or income, and you're looking for strategies for ASO growth monetization, go check out the App Masters YouTube channel and subscribe. There's tons of great information here. They are sponsoring this episode of Swift News, but I've been subscribed for a couple years now, and I even listened to Steve's podcast back in 2015 when I was first learning iOS development. So I was happy to help spread the word about his YouTube channel. In this video, the simplest way to build a six-figure app business is an example of the kind of content you can expect. Here he breaks down how an app is making six figures a year based on only about 100 downloads a month. And the key here is to find a niche ASO keyword that has decent amount of traffic, you know, nothing crazy, but decent, but not a lot of competition. And as you can see here in the chart, about 130 downloads a day, and that's generating nearly 8,000 a month in sales. And that is by finding a keyword that no one's really targeting and becoming the number one app for that keyword. So the idea here is that, you know what, it doesn't take a million downloads to make a decent income, but that is just one example of the type of content you can expect from the channel. Going back to their page here, I'm gonna scroll through their videos just to give you some ideas. They talk a lot about user acquisition, you know, whether it's paid or organic. He has a lot of guests on the show, right? They talk about bootstrapping an app to over 60 million downloads. There's app store optimization and ASA tricks on a budget. So again, if you're trying to grow your app business, this is an amazing channel to subscribe to. Again, I've been subscribed for years. So go check them out, subscribe. Again, tons of valuable information here. Next up, we have removing the M from MVVM with SwiftUI from Thomas here. And Thomas loves the shitpost on Twitter, and I love to watch it because he always riles people up, especially on this topic. But he developed Ice Cubes, the Mastodon client. It's an open source project developed in SwiftUI. So if you want to check out the code, you can go look at it. But throughout this article, he demonstrates how he builds a typical view, not using MVVM. I don't know what to call it. I've seen people try to give this a name. I'm just calling it the built-in architecture. So just to sum it up, but definitely go read this article. He really breaks it down. You're basically using the environment to handle your objects, which, you know, this client object right here does all the networking stuff for his app. This theme object here does a lot of the view customizations. So whenever you need those on a view, you just pull them down from the environment, use them accordingly. And now where you replace the view model here, or where you're kind of removing the need for that, is like, here's an example of a typical view. He talks about view state, but we'll move on to this part. What I want to talk about is that these simple functions, again, you can see him using the client environment object here, but you put these simple functions right on a view, which if you've done MVVM, like this would typically go in the view model, but putting them on the view eliminates the need for that. And having this client up in the environment that handles all the dirty work keeps these views simple. So that's the general idea. Use the environment, keep your views super small and minimal, and write these basic functions right on the view. That's the general idea. And I'm really coming around to this idea situationally. As with anything in architecture, there's no one right answer every single time. Let me give you some examples with my app CreatorView, which I use MVVM. I taught MVVM in my courses. And I even said back then, you know, SwiftUI is so new. MVVM was kind of like the de facto architecture in the beginning, but SwiftUI is so new, it hasn't been battle tested, it's not built in huge apps yet. Over the years, as that happens, new best practices will emerge. And I think that's what we're starting to see here as people move away from MVVM. But I'm not saying never use MVVM and always use this, because again, my app CreatorView, I think MVVM is helpful. Because what I've had to do for the iPhone, the iPad, and Mac, and the Vision OS is create separate UI files for those platforms. Now, yeah, the idea of SwiftUI is, oh, you can write it once and it works on all platforms. In theory, yes, and for a lot of views, that is true, but depending on what you're trying to build, you could end up with a ton of compiler directives in your UI code, especially if you're dealing with like landscape or dynamic type. You know, those concepts don't exist on a Mac, and a lot of the stuff on a Mac doesn't exist on an iPhone. The layout of the screen could be very different between a Mac and an iPhone. So in my specific example, I found it easier to create separate UI files. Now, MVVM is nice for that because you have the one view model that serves all these different view files. Whereas if I went with this approach that Thomas is talking about, these functions here, I would have to have on each of the different views. Now, while I was like planning this episode, I thought that there might be a way I could reconstruct things to actually adopt this, but I'd have to think more on that because I haven't done the deep dive there yet. But another downside to MVVM is sometimes you feel like you're fighting the framework. If you've worked with Swift data in MVVM, yeah, it's possible, but you know it's a major headache. And it, again, it really feels like you're just fighting against the framework. So that's my stance on things. I'm going to shift towards this default architecture that I'm calling it, that Thomas is talking about here, for most of my projects, unless there is a specific need, like in the example of Creator View, where I have multiple UI views and having a view model servicing them is beneficial. But also in Creator View, I'm using Swift data and MVVM is a pain in the ass. So again, there's nuance. It's very situational depending on what you're doing. And we'll wrap up this architecture talk with this tweet, because this is like really how I feel. I'm not religious about architecture, and I definitely don't believe on trying to force one architecture as like the main way to do things. So here's this tweet from Jonas. In my career, I've worked on apps written with nearly every pattern to separate Vue from business logic. MVP, MVC, MVVM, you name it. I've done it. I've also worked in teams consisting of just me to up to over a dozen devs on the same app, from a couple lines of code to hundreds of thousands of lines of code. Every pattern works. So I'm starting to recommend the MVW pattern, model, view, whatever. Here's the thing I like. Choose something your team likes or knows and just go build something. Like, don't get wrapped up in all this. Because he says, most problems are caused by over-engineering, not understanding the problem at hand and building unfitting solution, building the same thing multiple times without being aware of existing solutions. And then here's what I was just talking about with MVVM and Swift data, like going against the framework instead of with the framework. Moving on, I loved this article from the makers of Not Boring Apps. If you're not familiar with the Not Boring Apps, they make kind of simple apps like weather app, calculator app, except they make them not boring, very whimsical, very cool looking. That's kind of the whole brand there. But in this article, they talk about the sound of software and implementing sound design into your software. And you start off with this, right? Repetitive, disruptive, annoying. That's typically how sounds are. You know, most people turn sounds off in their apps, right? They don't even want to mess with it. Sound is an outcast in software design. We embrace the aesthetics of animation and visuals, but sound is different. Like, just get that out of here. Buddy mentions, right, you play a video game or watch a movie without the sound, you know, like the sound is vital to the experience. Sound in software isn't inherently bad. It's just been really badly designed. And now look, the examples I'm about to show you are for these not boring apps that, you know, their whole brand is being whimsical and different and not boring. That may not apply to your app. So I'm not saying do these exact examples in your app. I'm saying that you can use what I'm about to show you as inspiration to maybe think about the sound design in your app differently and improve it just a little bit that's appropriate for whatever type of app you have. Okay, so this is a really long article talking all about sound design. I'm gonna scroll through to the examples because that really illustrates it more than me reading a couple paragraphs, but definitely go read this if you're interested in this. I loved this article. This might be my favorite article of the episode, to be honest with you. So designing sound, break the repetition, right? The main reason most software sounds are annoying is you just blame it on repetition, right? Like the tick, 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 tick of Apple keyboards, but variation is the answer. So here's an example of button taps on their calculator, and I'll play this for you. So they start off with just the repetitive taps, the single sound. Right, yeah, pretty repetitive. And then we'll fast forward to the random variants. That's a much better experience, right? Now, of course, I'm not saying go add a bunch of bibbity boops and bops all through your app. Again, use this as inspiration to improve your sound design that's appropriate for your app. But I do think this can give your app that extra level of polish that really separates yourself out from your competitors. And then he talks about sound layers. And this is the last example I'll show you, but it's an example of just full, rich sound by layering multiple sounds instead of just using one sound. It's pretty cool. But anyway, read the article. The last thing I want to point out though, if you are going to do this with sounds, we'll keep going. Well, here's the code. Give back control. This is what I wanted to point out. If you're going to do this with sound, have options in your app to toggle on and off all the sounds or just tweak specific sounds. Let them customize their experience because they say it right here, like sound is intrusive. There's no denying that. So let people pick and choose which ones they want. Because no matter how cool your sound design is, there's certain people that are just gonna be like, I don't want no sounds, I don't care how cool it is. And then the last piece of advice with your sound design isn't really sounds, but sounds and haptics go so great together. So don't forget about those haptics. Anyway, read this article. I loved it. Use it as inspiration to improve the sound design of your app with what's appropriate, of course. Next up, we have a thread from Lickability, which takes a look at the quirks and features of the new Apple Journal app. And again, another really long thread that dives into the good and the bad design choices in the Apple Journal app. Definitely read through this. I'm gonna highlight a couple things that I thought were pretty interesting. So they talk about this pattern here, about having the keyboard toolbar above it, but below that, the sheet changes based on what you have tapped. Like it replaces the keyboard, and it's just a nice experience, and I agree. And I've never built this in any of my apps, but it, you know, gave me some ideas, some inspiration. As you can see, if they're tapping on the pictures, they get that. The keyboard pops up or record a sound. So I really like that pattern. I think that's clean, smooth. So that gave me ideas by looking through this. And then another one that I thought was cool, we'll go through it, is because it's one thing to just complain and point out what's wrong, right? You gotta provide solutions. So they talk about this nav bar in the editor and they break down, you know, what's wrong with it. Why can you preemptively bookmark an entry? How is bookmarking more important than canceling the draft? There's a more menu that has stuff that can be surfaced, right? Here's the bookmark that's one of the most prominent buttons, but you're just creating it. And then to change the date, you have to tap the more button and go to custom date. So again, offer solutions. Don't just point out mistakes. So I like this. Replace the bookmark button with the cancel button. Make the date here just a tappable date to change the date right there, and then done. So you completely remove this need for a more button, which buries things. And yeah, I totally agree with Lickability's improvements. But again, the point is to review this thread, see their breakdown, and then just get ideas, get inspirations for the apps that you're building. Moving on to the indie dev portion of the show, Chris here has a great piece of advice, and I've seen people doing this on Twitter and it's been working. Basically, if someone leaves you with a one-star review, like you know those one-star reviews where it's like, oh, this app made me pay. It's like, well, come on, that's not a knock on the app, right? There's these ridiculous one-star reviews that are completely invalid. You can actually protest those to Apple, and Chris shows you how to do it, right? You go to the App Store Connect, contact us, and then you can report a concern. And then customer review removal request. And like I said, I've seen people have success with this where they've gotten a few one-star reviews taken away. And if you take away the one-star reviews, that severely changes the overall average. So if you've got some one-star reviews on your app that aren't justified, hey, definitely go do this. Next, we have Revenue Cat giving advice on, am I a traitor? What does that even mean? Have you seen this pop up? This Digital Services Act from the EU that if you're going to update an app or submit a new app, you see this and it says, you know, are you a traitor? You have to declare. And most people are like, what even is a traitor? Like, I don't know if I'm a traitor or not. So Revenue Cat breaks it down in this article as to why it's even happening. Basically, the EU is passing various laws, which I like what Jacob says here. They're trying to regulate the internet. Okay. But anyway, if you're a traitor, essentially, if you make money with your app, you're probably a traitor. Now, of course, Revenue Cat says you're not lawyers, you might definitely want to check, but it seems pretty clear. If you make any money from your app from the EU, you're a traitor. But what does this mean for you? Well, this means if you're a traitor, you have to publish your address and phone number that's associated with your App Store account. Now, for many indie devs out there, that's your home address and your personal phone number. You really want that published on the App Store? So it's a pain in the ass, but if you still want to continue selling in the EU, because the option is to just pull your app from the EU, so you're gonna have to make that business decision, right? If you're not making a ton of money from the EU, maybe that's not worth it. You know, maybe your app is just getting off the ground, or you can spend the extra cost to get like a PO box or a virtual mailing address. Same thing with a virtual phone number like Google Voice. It's an extra cost, extra pain in the ass, but if you wanna continue selling in the EU, unfortunately, you're gonna have to do it. So if you've been confused if you are a traitor or not based on this pop-up that you've seen, Revenue Cat's got you covered. Next up, I really like this article from Jordan Morgan here, basing indie releases in the term of goals, because it really resonated with me in my app Creator View. I'll just get right to the punchline here. Definitely check out the article. But choosing themes for your app. And the themes he's talking about aren't like design themes, but like, what do you want to get out of this app? Like, what is the goal? And the themes he came up with for him, right? There's obviously more themes, but you know, what resonated with him were, are you trying to build a business? You know, are you trying to just make money from this app? Are you trying to test a hypothesis, which is, you know, experimenting with a different app? I like this one, for the love of the game, right? If you're an indie dev, a lot of us just love to create beautiful software. You know, you wanna play with the new APIs, even if it's not the best thing for the business of the app, that's for the love of the game. So I wanted to talk about these two specifically, for the love of the game and build a business, because this is the conflict I feel with my app. So Creator View, isn't doing great business-wise because I don't put a ton of effort into it, to be honest with you. A couple hundred a month MRR, whatever. But I fall into the for the love of the game category with it too much. And these are very conflicting. For example, you know, I want to play with new iOS APIs because it also plays into my business as like teaching this stuff. For example, I spent a lot of my summer ripping out core data, adopting Swift data and dealing with all those pain points, and then ripping out the old observable object and adopting new observable. So all the stuff, which is the new iOS 17 APIs, the shiny new toys, that means nothing for my business. Those 2 or 3 months I spent doing that, I should have been marketing my app to grow the business, right? So these two are in direct conflict with each other. So when you're starting a side project, or if you're trying to go indie and start your indie app, take a look at these two things. Like, are you going to do things for the love of the game, experiment with the latest and greatest, maybe build a Vision OS app when that's probably not the best thing you should be doing, you know, depending on your app? Or are you going like hardcore business? Like, I'm going to maybe sacrifice some design best practices, or, you know, not have fun with the new stuff because I'm going to try to build a business. Just make sure you know what you're doing before you start an indie dev project. And lastly, I like to show off Vision Pro stuff. And this was the Masters experience, the golf tournament on Vision Pro. And many people said like, oh, this is like the future of sports. This is when I realized Vision Pro was amazing. So you get the 3D model of the hole. You get to see, you know, different camera angles, the leaderboard right there. I think sports for the Vision Pro are gonna be amazing. I don't know if you've seen some of the immersive footage that Apple's done for some of the MLS soccer games, but feels like you're there. Anyway, that wraps it up for April's edition of Swift News. We'll see you in May.